Hey everyone, welcome to another Wildlife Wonders of Texas Nature Series video. In the last video, we talked about how to ID animals using their skulls, but in today's video, we're going to talk about habitats and adaptation using animal skins. Jumping right in. Adaptations are when an animal changes in order to better suit its environment. Now, sometimes it can happen really fast, or it can take many, many years.
Think about this. It is going to be 100 degrees Fahrenheit today. So in order to survive today, I know that I need to change into light, breathable clothing. Even though I could wear heavy and thick clothing, I would be lowering my chances of survival. I could suffer from dehydration, heat exhaustion, or even heat stroke. But let's say it was 32 degrees Fahrenheit and I was in light breathable clothing, I would have to change into heavy thick clothing to survive a freezing day.
As humans, we have the ability to change our clothes and prepare for survival. We can actively adapt day to day. But what about the Texas wildlife? Do they have the option to just throw on a jacket like us? No, but they are able to adapt to their habitat or home here in Texas. There are two types of adaptations, physical and behavioral.
Physical adaptations are body structures the animal has to help it survive. Think of fur, eye placement, teeth, shape of the animal, size, claws, beak type, and much more. Remember, physical adaptations are usually the things that we can see on the animal. Now, behavioral adaptations are either instincts or learned behavior that help an animal survive. Let me give you an example of a behavioral adaptation I saw just in my backyard. There was a monarch butterfly that laid its eggs on my tropical milkweed plant. I observed and recorded the complete metamorphosis of these beautiful monarchs for over a month until they flew away. Where did this generation go? Well, they went north to Canada. How did the monarch know to fly to Canada? The mother didn't teach them, and the mother didn't leave any directions for them. It was all instinct. The monarch just knew. Here's another example of behavioral adaptations that I noticed. I saw a squirrel that found some food and buried their treasure next to a tree, but another animal took it. So the squirrel got food and buried it next to another tree, and another animal took it. But then the squirrel found some food, buried it under a tree, and then place leaves over the buried spot, and the other animals didn't take it. So the squirrel learned that they have to bury their food and cover it with leaves so that way another animal wouldn't take it. Those are all examples of learned behaviors.
In today's video though, we're going to cover physical adaptations using the pelts of various Texas wildlife.
All right, so the first pelt we're going to look at is a white-tailed deer. And as you can see, it has a beautiful tan color, but the pelt is very coarse or rough. It's definitely not as soft as like a fluffy cat. But why does that matter? Well, I'm gonna use a hypothesis and guess that the deer has a coarse pelt because they usually have to run through obstacles, whether that be through grasslands with a lot of sticker plants or even some cactus, or running through a forest area with low-hanging pointy branches and small shrubs, or even a wet area with slippery wet surfaces. The fur has to be coarse because the deer brushes up against so many different things. Imagine if you were to run through a large field with tall, thick grass in just shorts and a tank top, you would probably come out the other side pretty cut up. But what about the color? If you could think about the colors that make up the different areas in Texas, what would you say? For me, I would say brown and green, which makes it perfect for a white-tailed deer to be able to camouflage to hide from predators. Bonus fact, the wildlife here in Texas are similar in color. Why? Well, even though Texas is a huge place, we are really, really lucky to have many different types of environments for a wide range of animals. Texas is actually made up of mostly grassland, forest, and coastline, not desert like everyone thinks. So the primary colors of Texas land are green and brown. So the animals have adapted over time here using natural selection to take the color that gives them the greatest chance of survival. Now, I said the white-tailed deer uses camouflage, which means that an animal can blend in with its surroundings, making it harder to see. Here's some footage in which I recorded different animals using camouflage to try to blend in with their surroundings. See if you can see every single one of them. Alright, so lastly, how do I know it's a white-tailed deer? Well, this is super easy, y'all. It has a white tail. What does it do? Well, if a deer hears danger, or it notices something sneaking up on it, it will fling up its tail and start waving it around to let the other deer know that something is wrong. It's pretty cool, right? Okay, so the next pelt we're gonna look at is a beaver pelt. As you can see, it is a beautiful brown color, and it is probably the softest pelt we have here. Anyway, the pelt tells a pretty cool story. I noticed that in the middle of the pelt, it is thick, but as I move toward the edge, it gets even thicker. Why? Well, I know beavers are found near sources of water, especially near rivers here in Texas, and they are really good swimmers. But imagine a beaver swimming around. Where is the belly? Is it facing the sun or facing down in the water? Its belly is facing down in the water, and since the water is cooler, the belly needs more insulation, and the upper part faces the Texas sun and doesn't need to be so thick because it would get really hot. And then the color is brown, like the wood they use to build their dams, so they can actually camouflage pretty well while inside their homes. So to me, I think the beaver has the coolest physical adaptations. Let's take a look at another pelt, the striped skunk. Now this striped skunk is very soft, extremely soft, like a cat. But hey, just because it looks soft, don't ever touch one in the wild. Actually, this is a great time to say, everyone, please do not go out and try to touch and befriend the animals in the wild. Now I love all animals, even though I'm still warming up to spiders. And yes, some might seem nice, but please respect them because you can get hurt or you can hurt them. So please, please, please enjoy the beauty of nature without putting yourself in harm's way. All right, back to the skunk. Notice these white stripes on the skunk. This is a physical adaptation that warns predators to stay away. We call it warning coloration or aposematic coloration. A few animals that I've seen use warning coloration are of course the skunk, but also the monarch butterfly, a black widow, a coral snake, bees, and wasp. Of course, there are many more, but those are the ones that I've recorded here in San Antonio. So yeah, another awesome physical adaptation.
So we talked about a lot in today's video. And as you can see, I have a lot of pelts that I actually didn't get to talk about, but that's okay, don't worry. If you're an educator, please check out the description below to find out how you can check out all of these pelts to use for your kiddos. What is the craziest animal adaptation that you've seen? Let me know in the comments below. I'll see y'all next time. Take care.